praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
I shall fire.
Fire.
Say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Glory be to God.
Amen.
Amen and amen.
Amen.
We bless His name.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's speak in other tongues. Bless the name of the Lord. Praise God forevermore. We bless His name.
Hallelujah.
Amen and amen. Our God is an awesome God. Lord, we thank you for your mercy and kindness and love. Thank you for the privilege to be gathered unto you. Lord, we say, blessed be your holy name. Unto you are we gathered. Lord, reveal secrets to us.
Amen.
May our hearts indict the good matter.
Thank
Lord, thank you for the utterance you granted us to boldly reveal your mysteries, and most importantly, may souls be won into your kingdom.
Amen.
Thank you for your precious children that are gathered here, O God. Lord, we say, glory be to you.
Amen.
Take all the glory. And whatever burden they have come with, may they never go.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus. As they rise, they rise in
truth. Amen.
In Jesus.
Amen.
Shall fire.
Fire.
Amen.
Amen.
When she comes to someone, it's so nice.
So nice to see you.
So nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
Delight to be here.
Yes.
We give all eternal multitudes of gratitude to the person of the Holy Spirit for being here.
Mm-hmm.
And also, we'd like to thank our most esteemed Papa Joshua Aguila, Mama MC Joshua Aguila, to be here for the grace given. And also, want to specially thank Sister Kenya. Time to come. Amen. Woo! I'd like to thank Sister Linda, so nice to see you. Sister Lisa and our household and our friend and others. Amen. Thank you.
Amen.
Praise God. We want to continue with our subject that we began the last time we visited Virginia, and we were teaching on why was the book of Genesis written.
Wow.
Because there is need for us to know why the book of Genesis was written. Now, you need to understand that Moses was the one who wrote the book of Genesis. And the motive for the writing of the book of Genesis was not for us to know how man was created. Really. That was not the primary reason. So, that science is trying to make a big deal out of the creation of man, to talk about the evolution of man, that man evolved from being a monkey into becoming a human, it's madness. But the thing is that God still revealed how man was created, that man was created from dust. A man was made from a monkey, and whoever is going to teach that is actually first the monkey himself to even teach that, to even think that way. Such a person must have even the brains of a monkey to think.
Yes.
that, I mean, look at how beautiful you are. Imagine somebody telling you you look like a monk. Dear God. No, I don't look like a monk. I'm not even a relative of a monkey. Yeah? I don't even look like a monkey. And you are too beautiful to look like a monkey. Even if you think you are. Do monkeys go to school? Monkeys don't go to school. No, please answer now.
No.
Do monkeys even wear makeup?
No.
So you can imagine how a monkey will even look trying to put lipstick.
Mm.
So I don't know how many, no matter how a monkey tries to be a human, it can never be. So it's madness.
Yeah.
But whoever is thinking that way needs help.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, but now I want to show you that the primary reason why the book of Genesis was written was not to tell us how man was created. Because you need to understand that the book of Genesis was not the first book to be written in the Bible. Okay, so when you see the chronological arrangement of the Bible, it doesn't mean that is the order in which it was written. That was certainly not the order in which it was written. The first book to be written in the Bible is the book of Job. The book of Job was the first book to be written. And Job had the privilege to talk about some information he was privileged to have access to concerning the creation. And it was prompted by a question, by a challenge that he put to God. He threw a challenge to the Almighty and requested for an umpire between him and God. He requested for an umpire. Then the Lord said, he said, let there be an umpire between me and the Lord. Let God tell me what I did wrong. Why are things just going bizarre in my life? Why is there so much calamity, chaos in my life? Children dead, business not working, and Satan is just after me. And he said, let God tell me what I did wrong. He said, and then let there be an umpire between me and God. Now, this was a man God was even defending before Satan.
Yeah.
Now, he now challenged God. At first, he blamed God for the cause of it, just like the way people today blame God for the things that go wrong in their lives. So, Job blamed the Lord. He actually said, the Lord give it and the Lord take it. How many of you have heard that?
Yes.
And it's not true. God does not take whatever he gives. If God gives you love, if you bring somebody into your life to love you, and the person now becomes something else, it doesn't mean God took the love away from you because you did anything wrong. It just means that the person just changed his mind to be who God wants him to be, or to be who God wants her to be. So you see, Job actually said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh. Blessed be the name of the Lord. How can you still bless the God who took from you what you desired the most? Then he now threw a challenge at the Lord and said, let there be an umpire between me and God. Let God tell me my wrongs. Then God said, what? You challenged me? Then, for the first time, we now heard God say, where were you when I created the heavens and the earth? So it was through that information, God knew. The one he was trying to challenge was the creator of the heavens and the earth. But the details to the creation, Job did not know. Job did not have that detail. But God, for the first time, revealed himself to a human being. That he made the heavens and the earth. Now, this was one thing God never told Abraham. Rather, when Melchizedek came to Abraham, he said to Abraham, you are the possessor of heaven and earth. He called Melchizedek the priest of God, who has no father, no mother, no beginning of days, no end of life, called Abraham possessor of heaven and earth. But how can Abraham be the possession of the heavens and earth that he never created? So Abraham never knew God as the creator of heaven and earth till he died. Never knew God as the creator of heaven and earth. Rather, God revealed himself as El Shaddai. And El Shaddai means the strong and breasted one. In other words, your provider, the one who provides for you. So that's all he knew God as. See? But God did not tell him he was the creator of the heavens and the earth. Rather, God sent his priest in the person of Melchizedek to tell Abraham, you are the possessor of heaven and earth. You see. But to Job, he said to Job, where were you when I created the heavens and the earth? And Job was baffled. Oh, I didn't know the person I was trying to challenge was the creator of the heavens and the earth. Then he began to confess. He said, oh, I've been hearing of thee by the hearing of the ear. He said, but now my eyes see thee. So all he knew initially about God until he encountered God was based on what he has been hearing. And all he heard about God were presumptions. They were not accurate. First of all, he blamed God as he saw God as the one who will give and take from you. Just like the way our parents today, they can give you cash, and then when you do wrong, then they say you are grounded. So he saw God that way, and God was not that kind of person. And there are many people today who have lived and died thinking that God is like that. Who thinks that when God can give them something, but when they do wrong, God takes it back. And start to say, even preachers preach it. And it's unfortunate to think that God is that way. Yet the Bible says that anything God gives you, he does not take it back.
Yes, sir.
Whatever God gives you, he doesn't take it back. So how come I lost what he gave me? Well, maybe one, carelessness. Mm-hmm. One. And again, you probably thought it was based on your own ability. Mm-hmm. You probably thought it was based on your own ability. But whatever God gives you, he does not take back. Mm-hmm. See? So how about, we can talk to you because my mom died when I was 8 years old. And I heard the priest at the burial, at the graveside, say, the Lord give it and the Lord take it. He said it. I heard it at 8 years old. So I always thought that God was the one who took my mother away. So I will tell you, at the beginning of my life, I did hate God. I hated the God that I'm defending, that sent me to. I did hate him. Why? I hated him for taking my mother away. How come he didn't take that person's mom away? Why is he taking my mom away? And my mom was my best friend at the time. So I was angry because I heard the priest say, the Lord give it and the Lord take it. Quoted what Job said and said, after all, it's in the Bible. Then he said to me, take her son, take her son. You know, God knows. I know you love her, but God loves her most. Really? So he loved her so much that he took her away from me. So I hated God. I did it until I got to find out that God never took my mother away. See? So who took your mother away? Well, my mom chose to die. He said, how do you mean? Because whoever dies agrees to the spirit of death to die. The Bible says life and death is in your tongue. See? You got what you wanted because you said so. Jesus said, you shall always have whatever you say. Whether you say it in ignorance, whether you meant it or not. The Bible says, you see, in Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verses 8, Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verses 8, he says, do not let your flesh, your body, your emotions cause you to say what you shouldn't say. And then say you didn't mean it. He said, then God will be angry.
Yeah.
You see, you know, sometimes our emotions can be so stirred, and we find ourselves saying the things we shouldn't have said. Then we say, no, I didn't really mean it. He says, when you say you don't mean it, then God will get angry. Isn't that amazing? That God gets angry when we say things we don't mean. Which means that he expects us to say what we mean. And if you are ever going to say something you don't mean, then shut up.
Yes.
Sorry for saying that, but that's the truth. If you are ever going to say something, so if I'm going to say I love you and I know I don't really mean it, then it's better I don't say it at all. See, because the Bible says that's what will get God angry. And it's amazing, it's written in the Bible, that what can get God angry is when you say what you don't mean. If people knew that, they probably would be careful with the way we talk.
Yes.
See? Because the Bible says, don't ever say what you don't mean, because if you do, God will be angry. And Job was that kind of person. So God said, what? You are putting me to a challenge? He said, where were you when I created the heavens and the earth? So he knew he was challenging the Creator of the heavens and the earth, and he didn't know. He thought he was challenging the one he has always heard about. But whatever he heard about that one was not even true. He heard that this one he was challenging gives and takes. And down through the years, since the days of Job, think about it, the book of Job is the first book to be written ever. Now, since that day, many are still believing what Job already said that God corrected him about. To think that God, that job God gave you, God will take it back. How can you pray for a job and God gave you this job? And now you lost the job and you think God took it away from you. No, first of all, let's look at the job. How were you behaving at work? See, instead of looking at yourself and examining yourself, you are blaming it on God who is innocent, who even gave you the job in the first place. Sometimes we don't want to take up responsibilities. We like to push it on God because God is not available to defend himself. But that's not true. So why was the book of Genesis written? And later on, Job actually said, the Spirit of the Lord made me. He said it, but how man was made, he could not explain. Yet the book of Job was the first book to be written. So now, why was the book of Genesis written? It was not written with the intention to let us know the story of Adam and Eve. It was never intended at all. It was for the children of Israel to know their history, how they came about. And this was precipitated by something that the children of Israel saw Moses do. And when they saw Moses do that thing, it provoked them to ask him questions. See, if you say the God of our father sent you, then tell us about this God. Who is he? So Moses had to take time to explain because of something they saw Moses do. So go to Genesis chapter 15. You know, in our last class concerning this subject, we did tell you that really, Genesis chapter 50 should have been the first chapter, and not Genesis chapter 1. But rather, Genesis chapter 50 should have been the first chapter, because if you study it carefully, you will discover, it will make you appreciate why the book of Genesis was written. Now, we told you that when the Roman Empire conquered the world, through Alexander the Great, they reinitiated a new order. Now, you need to understand that the Bible you and I are reading today is an Eastern book. It's not a Western book. It's an Eastern book telling us about the Easterners and how they related with the Almighty. Now, you and I, even though I come from Nigeria, in Africa, we are not Easterners. Certainly you also, as an American, you are not also an Easterner, you see. Now, you can't interpret an Eastern book with an American or Western presentiment. You need to understand why the Easterners wrote what they wrote and why things were the way they were then, which is different from the way things are with you here. And so, if you are trying to relate with this Bible based on how you live your life here in America, you'll be missing the point completely. You see, for instance, in America here, if I meet you and I give you a slap, right, and I slap you, chances are you will call the police, right? Mm-hmm. And if the police comes to arrest me, and they ask me, why did you hit her? Oh, I can say to the police, oh, I was trying to say hello to her. So you were trying to say hello to her? How can you say hello to her by hitting her? Oh, sir, from where I come from, we hit people when we want to say hello. Now, do you realize there are some African cultures, we're telling the truth, it's a fact. There are some African cultures, they will slap you many times just to say you are welcome.
Really?
Yeah. Yes. They'll be hitting your face. In fact, there's a certain African tribe where to welcome you, they have to slap you. And of course, if you live around that enclave, I mean, you're already used to the slap. Your face must have become very happy. Otherwise, if you are visiting, you have to be holding your face like this. Maybe you do like this, because you can do like this. But now, the question the police will ask me is, does she know that that's how you live on grit? If she doesn't, then it becomes a deliberate offense. You see that? Even though I may have a genuine intent, I'm trying to say hello to her, and I meant it. Oh, I'm so sorry. So how do Americans say hello? Oh, Americans say hello by either giving a handshake or they hug each other. He said, oh, I didn't know that. I thought they are like us. See, the reason why we use that picture is to say this. That's how Americans interpret the Bible today. They are trying to come to the Eastern culture and do the American way. But you don't understand how the Easterners behave and how they related with God. We need to know how they related with God so that way we can better appreciate what has been translated to us in English.
Mm-hmm.
And don't think English language is the best language because you speak English. No. Because you see, there are things, there are words that the English language may not be able to carefully communicate. That even native dialects, different other languages can communicate better. For instance, the word love, English language to this day has not been able to define what love is. Yet, the first people to let us know about love were Jews. The Easterners were the ones who introduced love to mankind, to let us know that there's such a thing called love. So now, if you are trying to say love is affection for one another, no, you might be wrong. Because even the Greeks interpret love differently. Because true love comes through knowledge. It comes by knowledge. So if I say I love you, it means that I must come to the point where I already know everything about you. And whatever you will do, I will not be surprised you did it. In fact, I will be surprised that you didn't do it. Then it will bring the question to whether I truly love you. No matter how nice you are. Did you understand?
Yeah.
So this will help us understand something. Genesis chapter 50. Now, the reason why we say what we said is because when Alexander the Great conquered the East and practically the world, the Roman Empire took over governance of the world. They introduced, listen carefully now, they introduced writing from the left to the right. See, the way we write now,
yes.
I can tell you now, if you even check your notebooks, mm-hmm. you write from where?
From the left to the right.
Please answer now.
Left to the right.
From the left to the right. You write from the left to the right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you know the Easterners write from the right to the left? And that is why the Muslims today still hold on to that structure. That's why even the Quran, you don't read it from left to right. You read it from right to left. Now, it's amazing that even the Torah, even the Hebrew manuscripts, are written from the right. And there's a reason why it is called right. Because there's a particular tribe in Israel who were known as leftists. They were all leftists. But there was something about the leftists. This particular tribe. The Bible actually said that this particular tribe, any arrow they shoot, they don't miss. When they throw a spear, anything they do, they are always very precise. They are always very accurate. Why? Because you see, if you bring that analogy into the way the Easterners wrote, that means that they started right. You understand? Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Writing from the right to the left. So they started right, and then when they finally get to the left, they are on point. They don't miss it. Do you understand?
Yes,
so there's a spiritual significance to the way they wrote. In fact, it was so bad, and the Bible did say that if they are going to write God, if somebody is writing you a letter, if I'm writing you a letter now as a Jew, and I'm going to mention the name of God in that letter, when I write and I get to the point where I'm going to mention Jehovah, I will stop and go and take a bath. I'll take my bath. Then I'll come and write God and keep writing. Now, if I'm going to write a one-page letter to you and I'm going to mention God 7 times, it means that I will take my bath 7 times to send it. And the Bible says, and they were very religious. Really. So they were setting this in head very sacred that we in the Western world don't seem to give much sacredness to. Do you understand?
Yes,
and it's no fault of yours. It's because we don't really know why that is so. Do you understand?
Yes.
Okay, so that's why when you now read from Genesis chapter 50, if you start reading from Genesis chapter 50, back to chapter 1, you will understand why chapter 1 was written. So now read the last verse. Read verses 25 and 26 of Genesis chapter 50. 1, 2, go.
Then Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel.
See, Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel. All right, let's read on.
Saying, God will surely visit you.
God will surely visit you. Mark the word of God. God will surely visit you. Okay. All right, read on.
And you shall carry up my bones from here.
Now, and you shall carry up my bones from here, right?
Yes,
okay, read the next one.
So Joseph died.
Being 110 years old. Okay, that's it. Read on.
And he was embalmed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And he was put in a coffin.
So he was embalmed and put in a coffin. Now, reading Genesis from, understanding the book of Genesis, and you start from Genesis chapter 50, verses 26. That would be like Genesis chapter 1, verses 1, right? So to we in the Western world, Genesis chapter 1, verses 1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Actually, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth is the last verse of the book of Genesis. So which means the first thing introduced to mankind was death. And so, death, okay, for you, for me to explain that, for you to understand proper, go to Exodus chapter 13. So let's look at Exodus chapter 13. So you look at, don't close Genesis 50, so we want to do something quickly.
Right.
Let's see how much you can take. Yeah. Right. Hope you don't mind if I rush you. Let me just rush. But we'll explain everything. It must make sense, right?
Yes.
Because you see, how can we serve a God that we don't really know? I don't like to serve a God that I don't know. I like to know who I'm serving. Yeah. So that when I'm praying to him, I can have that confidence.
Yeah.
That is he hears me when I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Right?
Yes, sir.
What's the point asking my friend, Sister Z, for something when I know she cannot hear me? If she cannot hear me, then I'm not confident that she can even grant me what I'm asking, right?
Yes,
now, it is one thing for Sister Z to even hear me. It is another thing to be sure whether she's even a good friend to me.
Yes.
Because if I'm not a good friend to her, no matter what I ask her, she will not do it. True of us.
Yes.
I mean, you're all like that, right?
Yes, yes.
So that means that I must have a good word, relationship,
yes.
A good friendship,
yes.
Right? Now, how can you serve a God that you're not even sure whether he's pleased with you?
Yeah.
You need to know about him. So if you're telling me God cares for me, does he? And you are not wrong for asking the question. You are very right. Does he care for me? So I say, he does. Well, if he does, how come I couldn't pay my rent last month and I was kicked out of the house? You have the right to ask. The question is, was it God who even told you to go live there in the first place? Or was it God? Was it God who took your money? Well, he was supposed to give me some money. I was told he cares for me. Well, do I have to give you money to prove that I care for you? See, because you are not a stupid person. Even a guy on the street without a job still says to a lady, I care for you, yet he's not giving her $1. Right? And the lady believes him. So care can be expressed in different forms. Two of us.
Yeah,
okay, fine. So now, let's see something. Exodus 13, if you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Now read verses 19. Read verses 19. 1, 2, go.
And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him.
And Moses took the bones of the embalmed Joseph with him, right? So that means Moses did open the coffin to be sure whether it was the bones of Moses. Now, mind you, this Joseph, Moses, the man of God, never saw. He had never met him before. Now, this was a man who died 430 years earlier. And you are coming to pick the remains of a man who died 430 years earlier. Wonderful. Okay, read on. Read on. Are you afraid?
For he had placed the children of Israel under
his own. No. Read verses. 19 again. 1, 2, go.
And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him.
Moses took the bones of Joseph
With him.
Uh-huh. Okay.
For he has placed the children of Israel under solemn oath.
Did you see that? We read that earlier, right?
Yes.
Genesis 15, verses 25. Yes. He made an oath with the children of Israel that they should not leave his bone, his remains in Egypt. But the people he made the oath to all died. Because if you read Exodus chapter 1, the Bible says Joseph and those in his generation all died. So the people he made the oath to died. But how come now Moses had to fulfill it, yet he was not the one Joseph made the oath with? You mean an oath that you make, a vow that you make with someone, can last that long?
Yeah.
It can last 430 years. Just normal conversation.
Yeah.
I promise I'll be there for you. You promise you'll be there. Just that remark can last 430 years. That means if I made this vow to you, that I'll always be there for you. It means that even my children and your own children must keep that vow.
Yeah.
That means that there is need for me to let my folks know the vow that I've already made with you.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So the question is, why is there divorces in the churches? Yeah, a lot of Christians are divorced. Why is there so much unfaithfulness between couples or between friends? Why is there so much betrayal? It's because they don't understand what Moses understood. That a vow that was made 430 years earlier can still last that long. Because the truth of the matter is that if they were going to have a safe journey through the wilderness to get to God, that vow must be fulfilled. Otherwise, they will not have a safe ride. So Moses was leading the children of Israel, yet carrying the coffin of Joseph. You know, there's people who think they know better than the past. You think you know better than your past. If only you know the coffin the pastor is carrying. You know, the moment you are made a pastor, you are a carrier of everyone's problem in your church. And the more people you have in your congregation, the more caskets you will carry. Now, this was Moses leading 3 to 6 million people. And there was death around him. Do you know how many children of Israel died? The Bible says those people who came out of Egypt, they all died. The only two people who never died were Caleb and Joshua that came from Egypt. But the others, Joshua and Caleb, took into the promised land were those born in the wilderness. Man, do you know what it means to lead the people and there's death all around you, yet you're still carrying the coffin? Even the Moses now, who was carrying the coffin, still did not get to the promised land. He himself died. The carrier of the coffin died. Then what now becomes the remains? Well, they didn't need to take the bones of Joseph into Canaan. He just said, just don't leave my bones in Egypt. Now we're in the wilderness. He can be thrown here. Say, Lord, we have fulfilled it. He said, was not leaving. We took him out. But the point is that the people began to ask Moses, why is there death? How did this thing called death begin? How did this thing called death begin? Where did death come from? Where did death come from? You know, people think that death came from Satan. Satan was not the one who brought death. And this was now what prompted the Holy Spirit to give the visions of the creation of man, the creation of the heavens and the earth, to Moses, so that Moses can begin to tell the people how man was created and how death came. Because if Joseph was a savior, and the Bible did say Joseph was a savior, he was a savior. Joseph actually testified by himself that God sent him to save the lives of the people. Now, if this savior can die, and this guy, he came as a prisoner, as a slave, was a prisoner, now became the prime minister of Egypt without going to school, what a phenomenal life he had. So, tell us about it. So that prompted Moses to begin to tell the children of Israel their history. And there is no way he could successfully tell them their history without taking them back to Genesis chapter 1 and begin to tell them the creation. You see? So if we understand Exodus, if we understand Genesis chapter 50 very well, then we can begin to appreciate Genesis chapter 1. Because it was all about death. Death. death had preeminence over everything. People were dying. And now here's Moses carrying the remains of a man in a coffin on his head. Yet he was leading 3 to 6 million people. Yet people have been dying. So since you said the God of our fathers sent you, then tell us, how did death come about? That was what prompted Moses to begin to tell them that really in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was even formless. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. Right? And the Spirit of the Lord moved over the waters. And God said, light be. He began to tell them the power of utterances when you speak. And then began to tell them that man was created in God's own image and likeness to rule over everything. Then the Lord planted a garden, put man in the garden, and said, of every tree in the midst of the garden, Genesis chapter 2, you may eat. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, there was a reason why Moses told them that. Because you see, what the children of Israel knew in Egypt was the knowledge of good and evil. Because the Pharaoh that had them bound for 430 years had over 1 million gods. Do you know that? 1 million gods. They were. There was the God for irrigation. There was the God for fertility. Mm-hmm. There was the God for the earth. In fact, in Nigeria where I come from, there's a particular tribe, like the Yoruba tribe, is a major tribe in Nigeria. The Yoruba tribe, they have over 400 gods. Mm-hmm. 400. Now, you and I are just even serving one. These ones are serving even 400. Mm-hmm. And they have logical, cosmological analysis for them. Does it work for them? I believe they are just serving demons. But yeah. But let's not go into that because they might also think that I'm serving a demon too. This one God you say you are serving, I believe he's a demon. So that's why I'm a believer. They are also believers too because they have what they believe and they see me as a non-believer to their beliefs. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yes.
And vice versa. Now here's the point. When God said to her, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat. For in the day thou shalt eat, thou shalt die. Mm. You see, Moses had to take time to tell them the origin of death because he was carrying the casket of a dead prime minister. See, the prime minister of Egypt. So you see here, Genesis chapter 15, the life of Joseph, his death precipitated, was the reason for the book of Genesis to be written. And there was no way Moses can explain it to them exhaustively without taking time to recount how it all began. Who the first man was. That this first man was not a biological body, he was created from the dust. And that this first man, God breathed into his nostrils. He became a living being. This was one thing God did not tell Job. God only told Job he was the creator of the heavens and the earth. But to Moses, he took time to explain how he created each thing. How he created even the trees. How the trees came about. He took time to explain. And so, this was one of the things Moses did for 40 years. He took time to be explaining to them. For the 40 years he led the children of Israel through the wilderness, it was taking time to explain. So, when you somebody says, I've read the whole Bible in 1 year, wonderful, thank God for you. But have you even understood Genesis? Because it took Moses 40 years to even explain it. It took Moses 40 years to explain it. So he was trying to explain how death came, that it was man by his disobedience that brought them. And that was why now he could bring them the law and told them, if you will obey the law, you will not be like the Egyptians. You will not die like them. Just like the way Adam died. See, he began to introduce them and told them, he was also introducing to them the need for giving offerings. When he talked about Cain and Abel, that an offering, not giving the right offering to God, can cause envy. Because Moses was a product of envy. they envied him so much. So he's saying, if you want to know why people are envious, when you see a man or a woman who is envious, it is because somebody gives a better offering than they do. Sometimes somebody has said, Brother, see, you seem to like people who give more than those of us who don't have. I said, I'm surprised you said so. But if that is the case, why should I accept you when you don't even give? See? So I shouldn't give audience to the one who gives. God has given us a vision. And someone believes in my vision and gives towards it. You also have the vision. And you don't believe in the vision. You expect me to love you more than the one who believes in my vision. Someone says, why do you believe more in the one who gives? Because the Bible says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Your money is your treasure. And if your money is your treasure, and your money is in something, your heart will be there. When you don't give, your heart will not be there. We wonder what kind of relationships people have today. So a man says, I love you, yet he has never given you anything. Rather, he's taking from what the mother has in the house. That glow, that shining glow, that glow that you can turn, all those sparkling things. He took it from his mother and says, he's giving it to you on your birthday. He didn't even buy it. He took the one in the house. That's not love. He stole it. That's not love. He said, because where your treasure is, your heart will be there. What can you say you bought me? If you never bought me anything, it means that your heart is not with me. It's easy for a lady to know which man really cares about her. Yeah. It's amazing, some ladies are just wonderful, you know. And of course, the men are wonderful. Because we can say anything when we need something. All right, let's come back. So now, he says, debt. The debt of Joseph prompted Moses, demanded the explanation, initiated an explanation that Moses had to give to these people. Why should somebody leave my dad? If you say the God of the Hebrews came to deliver us, who is he? How can he watch people die? So Moses began to say, well, this is how it all began. Actually, it was the man's that cost it. Then again, the women among the 3 to 6 million Jews who were with Moses began to ask, why is it that our men are always ahead of us? Because the Bible says, when if you read that Exodus chapter 13, verses 19 down, the Bible says Moses led the children of Israel in an orderly procession. Now that expression, the orderly procession, I think we should read it. Let's explain something to you. That orderly procession, read verses 19 down, read them.
And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him.
Yeah.
For he had placed the children of Israel under solemn oath, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here with you. Mm-hmm. So they took their journey from
Sukkot.
Yes. And camped in Ethan.
Yes.
At the edge of the wilderness.
Yes.
And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them the way.
Yes.
And the night in the pillar of fire to give them light.
Yes.
So as they go by day and night.
Yes.
He did not take away the pillar of cloud by day.
Yes.
Or the pillar of fire by night.
Yes.
From before the people.
Yes. Now, you see here that there's an expression. You see that they went in an orderly manner. Mm-hmm. You see? If you read from, okay, fine. If you start from verse 17. Okay, read from verse 17, you get to see it now.
Then it came to pass, when Pharaoh had let them, the people go, that God did not lead them by way of the land of the
Philistines, even though it was near.
Although it was near.
Okay, read on.
Least perhaps the people changed their mind when they saw war and returned to Egypt.
Yes. Okay, read on.
So God let the people around by way of the wilderness, of the Red Sea.
Okay.
And the children of Israel went up in orderly ranks.
Orderly ranks. Now, notice that's the expression. So, you see that orderly ranks was what precipitated Moses to tell them about Genesis chapter 3. See how God, in fact, chapter 2 into chapter 3, how God now made the woman. And then took the woman from the man. And then Adam saw the woman and said, you are bones of my bones, flesh of my flesh. You shall be my wife. There shall a man leave his father and cleave unto the wife. So Adam explained that. Then the woman and the serpent had their conversation. The woman ate, gave it to her husband with her. Then, you know, at this point, let's say something before we continue. Although our folks in New Jersey have taken time to exhaustively explain it to them. Now, people think Adam really ate the fruit. The word eat, when the Lord said, in the day you shall eat this fruit, you shall surely die. The word eat is the Hebrew word akar. Akar, say akar.
Akar.
A-K-A-F, akar. Say akar. Now, akar means to certainly eat and to certainly did not eat. That means akar is used for more than one person. You understand? It's not a word you can use in a singular form. It requires plurality. So when God even said, of every tree in the midst of the garden, eat, before the woman was made, that alone meant that there was going to be another person. Because akar is not a word that is used only for one person. Eat. That Hebrew word eat is the word akar. Akar means to certainly eat and to certainly did not eat. Now remember, as at the time God was telling Adam this, the woman was inside the man. Then God put the man into a deep sleep and took him out, took the woman out. Then Adam married the woman. They became one. Then the serpent came and said, the Lord says you should not eat of the tree in the garden. She said, well, the Lord says we may eat of every tree in the midst of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat. For in the day thou shalt eat, thou shalt surely die. Then the serpent said, but you will not surely die. You will be like God, knowing the difference between good and evil. Genesis 3, verses 5. Then verses 6 now says, when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, one to be desired to make one wise. You see that? So she desired wisdom. See? Women have always desired wisdom. It is in there, which is not wrong. It's good. But it matters where you go to seek it.
Yeah.
That becomes a thing. That's where divination comes in. When you seek the truth in another route outside of God, it's called divination. Because whatever the voodoo priest may tell you may still be true, but it is outside God. So it's called divination. Do you understand? And God is angry with that. When you go behind him to go and seek the truth elsewhere, other than him, it is known as divination. So now, here, she took it by, now Genesis and ate. Then the Bible says in verse 7 of Genesis chapter 3, she gave it to her husband, and he did eat. Now, if you understand that word, eat, literally, in all the churches, it has always been interpreted that Adam did eat. Adam did not eat that food. Why? If you go back to Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, God said to Adam, in the day you eat that food, you will surely die. Someone said, but Adam died that day. No, he didn't. Someone said, but the death was that their eyes were open and they were naked. No, that wasn't even the death. Many churches have interpreted it. I used to preach that until the Lord that was explaining to me. It's not true. That their eyes were open did not mean that was the death. That wasn't the death. Because if Adam really died, you now go to verses 8 of Genesis chapter 3. The Bible says, and Adam heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden. Then Adam went to hide himself. He went to hide himself. Hide? I told you we're dead. Now here's the point. The voice of the Lord came walking in the garden and called out to Adam and said, Adam, where are you? Who? God is asking Adam where he was. I told you should have known that Adam is dead. Because he told Adam, if you eat it, you will surely die. But, Genesis 3 verse 7 said Adam already ate. So, if Adam ate, he should have been dead. And God, he should have known by now that Adam is dead. So, God called out to Adam, yet he was expecting an answer. Yet he told him, if you eat, you will die. Come on, let's use our faith. If God says, if you eat, you will die. And yet the same God now is now calling out to Adam expecting Adam to answer. And Adam finally answered, oh Lord, actually, I heard your voice. I hid myself. I was ashamed and I was naked. He was talking. Ooh, he spoke. Adam spoke. God called out to Adam. Adam spoke back. Then that means the guy didn't eat it, because if he did, he would have been dead.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And God would have known, then he wouldn't call. Because this is one thing they have not been able to interpret in the churches. They say God was just trying to test him to see whether he will be honest. And that would make God a trickster. Does not make sense. That would make God a trickster. No, that wasn't the case. He actually said, where are you? Where are you? Imagine Adam said, Lord, I'm already dead because I ate it. God will say, but you are still talking. And this conversation was not in the spirit. This was in the physical. So he said, Adam, where are you? Someone said, well, spiritual, then Adam died spiritually. If he died spiritually, God will not be looking for him. God will not be looking for him. So he was still spiritually connected, even though he was naked. He said, I hid myself when I'm naked. God asked him, who told you you are naked? Who told you? I told God you can see that I'm already naked. God said, who told you? And Adam did not come out from his hiding place. Who told you that you are naked? He kept quiet. Oh, Adam realized, really, I'm not supposed to say it. God said, did you do what I told you not to do? Guess what he said? He said, the woman you gave me to eat a cow. So that means one party ate, the other party did not eat. Eve actually ate, Adam didn't eat a cow. It's a word used for more than one person. So somebody said, so but why was Adam naked? We'll tell you. Genesis chapter 2, from verses 22 down to verses 24, Adam already said, two shall become one flesh. The moment he said it, it's binding. So when Eve ate, it affected him because he prophesied. The Bible said, whatever Adam said, it was so. Whatever Adam said, it was so. He said, two shall become one. So when Eve ate, he has already married her. He said, cleave to the wife. Two shall become one flesh. The nakedness, was it from the spirit or on the flesh?
On the flesh.
On the flesh. You see, that was all happening. All right, so you can still study it. You get to see a cow. Okay, now, the children of Israel, when Moses was leading them, they walked in a procession in an orderly rank. The women had issues with that. Why is it that these men are ahead of us? Because this was what happened. The cloud was leading them. Moses was next to the cloud with the casket of Joseph. Then the men were behind him. Then the women were behind the men. All the women were behind the men. Then the children were behind the women. That was why the lives of the Amalekites could come behind and kill the children. And God swore he would kill the Amalekites. So the women were not surprised. Why is it that these men are always ahead of us? That was what prompted Moses to tell them Genesis chapter 3. That this is how it actually happened. And so when this woman quested for wisdom through some other means, God was angry. And it brought anger. God had to curse the ground for man's sake. And God cursed the woman with conception. He said, I will multiply your conception. Then God answered all your desires. Genesis 3 verses 16 to 17. Genesis 3 verses 16 to 17. All your desires shall be to your husband and he will rule over you. So you see, Moses was beginning to answer the questions the people had as he was leading them. So it is that part you read in Exodus chapter 13, verses 17 down, that says they walked in an orderly rank that prompted Genesis chapter 2 into chapter 3. So you see, Moses was taking time. So it all began with the death of Joseph. And the whole thing began to spiral, to spread. The ripple effect began to go that way. So much more. But you see here, you see why Exodus chapter 50 is really the first chapter. Then it was now time to give offering for the building of the tabernacle. Oh, then he began to tell them about Cain and Abel. First fruit. Now, in fact, Exodus chapter 12 into chapter 13. Remember, we're reading Exodus chapter 13. But Exodus chapter 12 into chapter 13, the Lord said, pick the firstling of a sheep on the 10th day of the month of April, Abib. And then 4 days after, which is the 14th of April, slaughter it and roast it. Don't boil the lamb. Eat. A four-year-old lamb. Eat. And then he now says in chapter 13, verses 1 to 6. Chapter 13, verses 1 to 6. He says, every firstborn belongs to me. Yeah. Is there anyone that opened up the matrix, the womb, belongs to me, and they must be redeemed? Even the lamb, any animal, their firstborn must be redeemed, otherwise you break his neck. And every firstborn of every woman, of every human, must be redeemed. So they gave offerings. Now, why? When Moses was telling them that, they asked Moses, why does this thing have to be? That was what prompted Moses to take them to Genesis chapter 4 and began to tell them the origin of Cain and Abel. And the first offering the Almighty required was the first fruit offering. That's why it's called firstlings. You see, as he was leading them in the wilderness, it all began with the casket of Joseph. So you see, as you read back, now notice, you see why the writing is from right to the left.
Yeah.
But we try to read it from the left, Genesis chapter 1, verses 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So he didn't even tell them the creation first. He told them the subject of death first, because that was what was prevailing over them. The Bible said they were all their lifetime subject to bondage because of the fear of death. So they had the fear for dying. So Moses had to take time to explain. This is how death came about. It wasn't God who brought them. It wasn't God who brought them. It was man by his disobedience. That's why in Exodus chapter 30, verses, sorry, Deuteronomy 30, verses 19. I think we should read it. Deuteronomy 30, verses 19. Deuteronomy 30, verses 19. You get to see something. Something very exciting. You see, because once you understand this, that's why now, in the New Testament, we are not told, the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. He is the last enemy. Why? Because he was the first enemy to be revealed to the children of Israel. Why do people die? Like we said, Job was, the book of Job was the first book to be written, and the first thing to be revealed in the writings of Job chapter 1 was death, the death of his children. 10 children died. But how did this thing happen? So death was the first reason why the book of Genesis was written, to understand where it came from, how it can come. And the reason Moses gave is still the reason today. Disobedience is what can bring death. That's why somebody can lose a job. If your boss tells you to do something that you don't do, you can be fired. That's death all by itself. The word divorce. The word divorce is a military word that means death. Divorce actually means death. That word divorce means death. That means the marriage was a living organism. And when divorce comes, there was death. Now, how can whoever is requesting for the divorce is actually, whoever proposes divorce is actually the one initiating death. So why are you initiating death? So when someone comes and says, I want a divorce. Maybe a man says, I want us to divorce. Then you're initiating death. You see, there's a disobedience somewhere. Why should death come in? And this is what has not been understood. Because if we have been teaching this, even in marriage classes, then we can better be careful in understanding. This person that I'm going to marry, that means I will be with her till death, no matter what. But I will not be the one to initiate death. Except she dies. But I will not be the one to initiate death. She can be crazy all she wants, but I will not be the one to initiate death. And I don't think the woman would like to be the one to initiate death. Because if you treat her right, she will not want to initiate death. And that's the truth. Because you see why marriage is not even for boys, it's for men. Do you realize if you are asking for a divorce, you are already initiating death? Yeah, but I want to leave her because she's not as beautiful as Susanna. But do you realize that what you're doing to her is something you also do to Susanna? You're going to do it to Suzanne too. But here's the point. Look at Deuteronomy 30. Deuteronomy 30, right?
Yes.
Can you read verses 19?
Yes.
Okay, read.
I can't.
This is the Almighty talking. He was telling Moses to tell the children of Israel. Actually, Moses was even talking to them. Go ahead. He says, I call heaven and earth to record this day, to witness this day against you. What?
That I have set before you life and death.
Read on. Blessing and cursing.
Therefore choose
life.
That both you and your
generation will live. See that? So one choice you make can either sustain your generation, or one choice you make can destroy your generation. So you see why I said my mother caused her death? See? Because she probably made the wrong choice by saying what she shouldn't say. He says life and death is in your tongue. That's why I speak like. When I first became a Christian, because I had a crude upbringing. To this day, I don't call my dad daddy. I've never called my dad daddy. Because I don't know how he sounds. I'll be deceiving myself if I say daddy. I didn't grow up in a normal home. I was a street boy. But now, I say that to say this. You see, when I became a Christian, the first thing I had to learn was to change the way I talk. I used to be nasty to people. I used to say all manner of things. And you know how Nigerians like to copy Americans. So we had to learn bullshit. We have to learn get out. We have to learn fuck you. We say all those things. In Nigeria, man, they say it worse than Americans. And I used to say those things. Man, I didn't know how it sounded. But I used to say, and I hated everyone around me. See? Because I saw everyone as the enemy. And I saw my mother as my best friend, but he didn't give her time to leave. See, but how can I make the dead my best friend? See? And some people are saying, so some go as far as putting a tattoo, rest in peace, Delilah. Delilah. who is Delilah? My girlfriend, my best friend. Is that what you're holding this? So how about Suzanne that is coming into your life?
Exactly.
Then she'll give you a hug and see rest in peace, the life. Mm-hmm. Then when this one dies, where would you put her? Stomach over. It's mad as well. But here's the point. This is choose life. So that you and your generation. So the choices you make will determine how far your generation will last. You see, some families, they die early.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because someone made the wrong choice.
Yeah.
That is causing the death of everyone. Mm-hmm. But someone in that family can have access to this kind of knowledge and make a decision.
Yes. Yes.
See, my mother's family, they used to die early.
Mm-hmm.
My mom's mom died when my mother was 2 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And she was in a business. She owned a big mall in a place called Idiaraba in Sulele, Lagos, Nigeria. Don't worry, you visit it someday, you see. In that place, see, an 18-wheeler truck, veered out of the road, skied into the mall and killed her. And my mom was just 2 years old. Then my mom died at 28, too. So you see, there was the spirit of untimely death. There was but when knowledge came to me, I chose not to die.
Yes, sir.
Someone said, no, it is God that kept you. No, I chose not to die. The first thing I did, by choosing not to die, was to change the way I talk.
Yeah.
Change the way you talk. No matter how angry you are,
don't
be nice, nasty.
Yes.
Be careful when you say somebody is stupid.
Mm-hmm.
Usually, when I'm angry, I say this person, I just wonder.
Mm-hmm.
I had to train myself to talk that way. I was not born that way. I used to be nasty. But I had to change the way I talk. Because if I'm going to live a better life and a fulfilled life, I stop saying I'm tired. You will never hear me use the word tired. People say it all the time. Rather, I just say I just need to refresh. And our folks know. No matter how exhausted I am, I always say, man, I just need to go and refresh. But I don't say I'm tired. Tired is something I will never use. I don't say I'm scared. I may not be comfortable with something. It doesn't mean I'm scared. It's one word I will never use in my language. I'm scared it's going to rain. No, it's going to rain. Don't say I'm scared. Most people that I'm scared, I don't say I'm scared. I don't talk that way. Because I know what my tongue can initiate. And did I pass every exam I wrote? No. I had a D graduating. But when I became a Christian, I learned never to say I failed my exam. Even when I had a D, when they asked me how was the exam, I always say it's a bonus A. It's a bonus A. Just like it came in D form. It's a bonus A. Well, I had to deliberately change the way I talk because I knew where I was coming from. And I've seen the face of poverty. Poverty is very ugly. You Africans have not seen poverty. I mean, you've not eaten rotten food. I have eaten rotten food. I ate rotten food for 10 years. Rotten food for 10 years. So, I mean, you can still walk into McDonald's, somebody can still buy a $5 burger, or go to White Castle and eat those small onion rings. First time we had onion rings, I can't have bought it for us. Man, she said, have you tasted onion? I said, I don't think so. Then she bought it. Yeah, man, I like that thing. Man, if I was eating onion rings for 10 years, brother, I think I would have been fine. Yeah. But we're eating rotten food in the village. See? So the point is this. Change the way you go. So you see, the reason for the book of Genesis was not just to tell you a story of the creation. It was what was currently happening to the children of Israel as Moses was leading them to the promised land that precipitated all the stories. Then have Abraham come about. He told them, the God of your fathers, Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. So the people, they were in Egypt at that time, and Moses came to deliver them. So they asked Moses, man, tell us about this Abraham. This is our father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There was no way Abraham could tell them that story without talking about Noah. Because it was one of the descendants of Noah, Shem, that gave birth to Terah, who became the father of Abraham. So there was no way Abraham could, Moses could tell them about Abraham without telling them about Noah. And the story of Noah begins in Genesis chapter 6. Then the Egyptians, of course, because the first civilization of the world was in Egypt. The Egyptians knew about the destruction of the earth with flood. And the children of Israel, having been in Egypt for 430 years, they knew about the destruction of the earth with flood, but they never knew the details. Never knew the details. So they asked Moses, how did this destruction of the flood come about? Then Moses began to tell them, oh, angels came and married women. Women were beautiful. Can't you see them today? They are still beautiful. They are even more beautiful today. Okay. So, angels came, saw that the daughters of men were beautiful, and married them. And that's how giants. Actually, what prompted the whole, not necessarily the flow, there were people who had abnormal growth, giants. So they asked him, how did giants come about? Why is this person taller? Yet you say God made us. Then he said, oh, actually, these ones are not God's creation. Angels were the ones who married women and corrupted the human race. Then giants came about. So God destroyed the earth because they had corrupted the human race and there was wickedness in the earth. These were the reasons. As they were asking the questions, Moses was seeing the visions to explain to them in all 40 years. So you are looking at the journey, the book of Genesis, from Genesis chapter 1 to 50, you are looking at a journey of 50 years, and as Moses led them, he took time to explain. And of course, on a few occasions, he was away in the mountain with the Lord. But he would come, each time he was around them, he would take time to reveal to them what the Lord was revealing. But it all began primarily with the casket, the bones of Joseph. Now, something I want to show you. Go back to Genesis chapter 13. Genesis chapter 15 and Exodus 13. Something I want to show you again. Right? Genesis chapter 15, verses 25, and Genesis and Exodus chapter 13. Now, so far so good. Does it make sense to you?
Yes.
Yeah, it should.
Yes, sir.
It should. Can't you see the beautiful brains you have? Beautiful brains. Yeah. Say, my mind is blessed.
My mind is blessed.
Yeah. You know, sometimes in the churches, they think we are stupid. But we are not stupid. We preachers, so sometimes we can presume that people are stupid. No, but whatever they are preaching should make sense to us. Otherwise, I won't come to church the next time. And I used to ask questions. And some people today are afraid to ask. I don't want to ask pastor questions so that pastor will not be angry with me. No, you have the right to know. If you want me to keep coming, answer my questions. And when our ministry first began, the first thing the Lord told us was to take people's questions. People will ask a question. Then the Lord will give me the answers. I'll tell them, this is it, this is it. And it was making sense. So they kept coming. And today they are vibrant in their lives. See? Because if you can answer my question, then it will determine, it will be up to me, based on the way you answer my question, to prove whether you are genuine or you are not. How do you know when someone is fake? You can tell. If the information has not even improved your life, then you know this one is not real. How can I keep coming to church, collecting the offerings from the people, or keep giving offerings, and what you are teaching me still does not make sense, yet you still want my offering? Because if going to school, whatever you have been taught in class does not make sense, would you register for the next semester? Certainly not. The same thing too. The same thing too. Right? Okay. Now, let's read something in Genesis chapter 50. Right, read verses 25 again. Let's see something Joseph said. Okay, read on.
Then Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you. And you shall carry up my bones from here.
Now, the part we want you to see there is the word God will surely visit you. Mark the word God. Okay. Now, read Exodus 13, verses 19.
And Moses took the bones.
And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him.
For he had placed the children of Israel under a solemn oath.
Saying, God will surely visit you. See, he's repeating it again. Right? So Moses was acting based on what Joseph already said. Right? That he saw in the vision that he reported. Moses was the one who wrote Exodus too. Right?
Okay.
Now, it's amazing that Exodus chapter started in chapter 1, but now Moses is beginning to tell us. The children of Israel began to leave Egypt at chapter 13. Yeah? Okay. Now, let's show you something. You see here that word God. That word God, when he says God will surely visit you. Right? God will surely visit you. Now, put your marker here and go to Exodus chapter 3. This was when Moses was leading the sheep. Then he led them to the back of the desert and saw a bush on fire. Then he said, man, strange sight. This bush is not consumed, yet it's on fire. I will turn to see what it is like. What is the meaning of this? And the Bible, when he turned, God called him and said, Moses, Moses. Do not come any further. First of all, take off your shoes. Where you are standing is holy ground. Okay. Then he began to speak. I want to show you something. Can we read verses 6 to verses 8? One to go.
Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses in his face. For he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrows.
Okay, now read verses. Read verses 8, want to go.
So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians.
Okay, read them. So I have come down to what? Deliver them out of the hands of who? Okay, read on.
And bring them up from the land to a good and large land.
Please read on now.
Unto a land flowing with milk and honey.
Are you afraid to read?
The plains of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites.
First, now go to verses 10.
Come now, therefore.
Please read now. Read with boldness. One, two, go.
Come now, therefore.
that you may bring my people,
the children of Israel, out of Egypt.
Now, did you notice? God met Moses in the mountains, in the desert. God himself did not enter Egypt. He met Moses in the desert. Then he said, I have come down to deliver my people because of their taskmasters. Where? Here, in the desert. The people under oppression, in Egypt. Why don't you go there and deliver them? What are you doing here? Well, the same thing he did to me too. See, you are here in America, but he reached out to me in Africa and said, nah, I'm sending you to America. You see that? That's how God works. See, like the way he sent Moses, he sent you. But now, notice something he said. He said, now, nah, come, Moses, I'm sending you to Egypt. God, go by yourself. Moses did not know they were suffering. The one he tried to help by killing the Egyptian framed him up, so he ran away. He has left them alone. God, you are the one saying they are suffering. Go by yourself. God said, now, Moses, I'm sending you. Now, there's a reason why we took it to that Exodus chapter 3. The word God there, when he says, when Joseph was saying, God will surely visit you. The word God is the word Elohim, which means plural for God. Follow this carefully. Which means more than one person. Yes. Right?
Yes, sir.
But it so happened that Elohim means a divine being. Follow this carefully. A divine being. Now, when you read Numbers chapter 12, when Miriam and Aaron confronted Moses and said, you take too much upon yourself, you think you are the only prophet. God told Aaron and Miriam to come forward after sending Moses. So they came forward. He said, three of you come. When they came, Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Then God told Miriam and Aaron to step forward. So Moses was behind. Then the Bible says God came and stood in the form of a pillar and said to them, if there is a prophet among you, I myself will make myself known to him in dark speeches, in different, in dreams, and all that. He said, Moses is not like that. Moses is someone that I don't talk to in a dream. I come to talk to him mouth to mouth. The word mouth means bosom. That means I hug him to talk to him. Do you understand? Then the Bible says, when Moses came down, each time Moses comes down from the mountain, his face will so shine with the glory of God. Now, the glory of God upon Moses' face was so evident that they had to tell him to wear a veil, just like the way a veil was used to cover the most holy place. Do you understand? So that means that Moses was carrying the holiest presence of the Almighty on his face, that the people could not stand looking at him. What does that make Moses? A divine being.
Yes, sir.
A God.
Yes.
God now sent to Moses, I'm sending you to the Pharaoh. You will be as a God to the Pharaoh.
Yes.
Do you understand?
Yes.
So when and the word God, Elohim, means ruler. Mm-hmm. One who leads a people. Mm-hmm. So you see here, Joseph spoke about Moses. Mm-hmm. Yet he called Moses a God. Mm-hmm. Even God told Moses, you are a God to the Pharaoh.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that God exalted Moses, a biological mortar born, to the corridors of the Elohim. Because only Moses could tell you about the creation in exhaustive detail. So that means that for Moses to see how the creation was, he came into the corridor of Elohim to be a God. Because it takes an exaltation like that by the Almighty to see the beginning of creation. How God began the beginning, then Moses was a strange being.
Yes.
So you see how he became a divine being.
Yes.
That means that there is a knowledge you can have. Moses, and Paul the apostle said, he got to the third heavens and had access to revelations that were not lawful for him to utter. Now, look at Moses. God brought him to the corridor of the Elohim, a mortal, biological born. No angel appeared to his mother when he was born. The reason why we're telling you this is that it doesn't matter what your case is. God can still exalt you that way.
Amen.
If you did it for Moses, he can do it for you.
Yes, sir. Amen.
You can do it.
Yes, sir.
It doesn't matter what I have. That's why I'm not an ordinary person.
I'm not an ordinary person.
Say it to yourself,
I'm not an ordinary person.
I'm not an ordinary person.
I'm not an ordinary person.
Jesus was a biological bone. But he lived a supernatural life. Yeah. Paul was a biological bone. He lived a supernatural life. Jeremiah was a biological bone. These men live uncommon supernatural life. You also, you are a biological bone, so you qualify.
Amen.
Say,
I live the supernatural life.
Yeah, it's your right.
Amen.
And that's why what is killing others should not kill you.
Yes, sir.
Cancer cannot find expression.
Cancer cannot find expression in me.
If people are dying of cancer, not me.
Not me.
Cancer is not welcome in my house.
Everyone is going to surgery,
not me.
Not me.
I'm free from every sickness.
I am free from every sickness.
If people are becoming broke, not me.
Not me.
See?
Exactly.
See, if God can do it with my life, yet I used to eat rotten food. How about you guys eating onion rings? He can do something great with your life, right?
Amen.
Say, I'm a successful.
I am a successful more.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
All right, for the benefit of those who are watching us, if you have not made Jesus the Lord of your life, see, you have an opportunity to do so. The Bible says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Someone said, but I believe in God. Well, the Bible says demons believe in God too. Yet they are going to the lake of fire. Someone said, do demons believe in God? They do. James chapter 2, verses 19 says, demons believe in God. So if you say you believe in God, it doesn't mean you will go to heaven. Believing in God will not bring you salvation. Otherwise, demons would have been saved. Someone said, but I believe in Jesus. That was before Jesus died. But after he died and rose from the dead, we are told to believe his resurrection. He says, if thou shalt believe that God raised him from the dead, that's what we are commanded to believe. He says, then you'll be righteous. That's what believing his resurrection will bring to you. It will bring you righteousness. It's not the good things you do or the charity homes you visit that makes you righteous. But believing that resurrection is what will make you righteous. Someone say, how about confessing of my sins? The Bible never said if you confess your sins, you'll be saved. Never said so. Preachers say, but it's not true. It's not in the Bible. Rather, it says if you confess your sins, you'll be healed. James chapter 5, verse 16 says, confess your faults to one another. Pray for one another that ye may be healed. James 5, 16. Each time Jesus wanted to heal the people, he would say to them, your sins are forgiven you. You see, forgiveness of sin, confession of sins, is connected to healing. You can be healed and still go to heaven. So, at this point, what are we supposed to confess? The Lordship of Jesus. He says, if thou shalt confess the Lord Jesus. See, confessing the Lord Jesus is far greater than confessing your sins. He says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He didn't say, whosoever confess their sins will be saved. I'd like you to join us in. Say, Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
Thank you for your Son, Jesus.
Thank you for your Son, Jesus.
My Lord.
I declare him Lord.
Because I believe.
Because I believe.
He rose from the dead.
For my justification.
And at this moment,
I confess with my mouth.
That Jesus Christ.
Is Lord of my life.
From this day forward, to the glory of God.
My Father.
Amen. If you have just made that declaration, I'd like to congratulate you and welcome you into the family of God. I'd like to pray for you. Father, we thank you for those who have acknowledged the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you because your word says, whosoever cometh to you, you will know why it's cast away. Lord, we ask that you put your seal upon them, the seal of the Holy Ghost. May these ones never be lost, O God. May they never drift away. May they never backslide. Lord, guide them, help them. And O God, may these ones, O God, never have an unfruitful end.
Amen.
Father, may their lives be glorious from this day forward. And may their lives be full of testimonies.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Father, bless these ones. May they flourish. Lord, give them uncommon revelations.
Amen.
May they excel beyond leaps and bounds.
Amen.
And may they always get to the top.
Amen.
May they remain on top.
Amen.
May they never go down.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus. There is no death in your power.
Amen.
Anyone that is sick will declare you free.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Shout fire!
Fire!
Amen and amen. If I say to someone, congratulations.
Congratulations, everyone.
Amen and amen.
Amen.
Praise God. All right, let's go. Praise God. Let's go. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.